morning, students. Welcome to Natural Science and Health 6. I'm Dr. Sirka Chiningayamwe, and I'll be your tutor for this specific subject today. I am aware that all of you guys have a study guide for Natural Science and Health 6, and fortunately, I have authored that module, so I know what's happening in the study guide, and it's very comprehensive, and it's there to really guide you to be able to prepare well for your exam. I have also been the one who have compiled your assignment tasks as well as your examination papers. So again, that is very much aligned to the study guide that I have given you guys. So you don't need to really get out of your way to read outside the study guide to be well prepared for the exam. However, if you go through the study guide, there are prescribed readings which you can also visit in order to be able to advance or to understand some of the concepts that you are not clear on. So to start the lesson, I'm just going to go through some of the key things that I think you need to be aware of to be able to write your Natural Science and Health 6 examination. Unfortunately, because of the time limit, I'm not going to be able to go through all the different aspects, but I will highlight some of the key issues which you need to know so that at least you'll be able to pass your April exams. So to start off, if you go through your PowerPoint, I'm sure that you have received the slides on your portal. So if you go through the PowerPoint, the first slide is looking at what or orientating you to the study guide, which I'm sure you are familiar with by now, especially because I expect you to have used it when you were writing your assignments. So the study guide is structured in such a way that there are 11 units, and then the units covers different knowledge areas of natural sciences as well as health. The learning outcomes of each unit have been outlined after each introduction. Additional readings are also suggested at the beginning of each unit, and the reference list is given at the end of each unit that might be useful for further readings. Each unit is made up of a series of learning and assessment activities, and usually we advise students to go through these activities before looking for answers, which are usually provided in the form of feedback at the end of each unit. So I strongly advise that you walk through those different activities because they are also aligned to some of your exam questions. And only once you have gone through those activities and you think you know what's going on, I advise you then look at the feedback for answers. And at the end of each unit, there is also a glossary list which is just there to help you define some of the terms that are difficult. And when you also go through your study guide, there are exact learning outcomes that you are expected to know by the end of this module. And I'm going to quickly just go through some of those learning outcomes, and they are aligned to the different units of the study guide. So the first outcome, for example, is that you should be able to explain experimental techniques, and you should be able to describe the characteristics of atoms, elements, molecules, and compounds. In addition to that, you must be able to analyze the different types of bonding in the structure of matter, and we're going to look at that shortly, and be able to explain some of the terminologies and also do calculations. And you must also be able to do calculations based on the different chemical reactions. And when you write your exams, you'll be provided with a periodic table, which is one of the essential tools that you need to be able to answer the obvious questions, especially when it comes to doing chemical reactions and also being to analyze some of the formulas to be able to give, for example, the relative formula mass. And the next slide looks at the units that are covered in the study guide. Like I already said, it's really just an orientation. That the first unit looks at experimental techniques. Second unit looks at characteristics of atoms, elements, molecules, and compounds. Third unit looks at the different types of bonding and the structure of matter. And that is specifically one of the very important units that you guys are supposed to have mastered for the exam. So you need to work through all those activities and all the different examples that are given in that specific unit to be able to answer most of your exam questions, hence my emphasis. And then unit 5 looks at production of energy, energetic and speed of reactions, also very important. And unit 6 orientates you to the differences between acids, bases, and salts. Unit 7 is about the periodic table and also being able to understand how the periodic table is structured. And then Unit 8 looks at properties, extraction and uses of metals. And Unit 9 looks at industrial uses and application of chemistry. Unit 10 looks at organic chemistry and structures. And then the last unit looks at impacts of chemistry on the environment. So I'm going to go through the 11 units briefly, and like I've already said, unfortunately, in the interest of time, I will not be able to unpack any of those concepts in detail. I'm just going to really highlight and touch on some of the things so that it can give you ideas as to what is expected of you in the April exam. So the first unit looks at experimental techniques. And for you to be able to answer questions based on that first unit, you need to understand how volume, mass and temperature is measured. And this is really basic chemistry. So if you go back to any chemistry book, you will find resources on how volume is being measured and how mass and temperature is being measured. And you need to understand the changes of state. So you need to understand the solids, the liquids, and the gases, and then being able to explain how solids changes to liquid, or liquid change to gas, or how gas changes to liquid. So that's very important to understand. And then also working through the melting and boiling points, because we know that different elements have different boiling points. So you should be able to explain how that happens and how that, for example, can influence the reactions of different elements. And then understanding how mixtures can be separated through different processes such as filtration, crystallization, recrystallization, and simple distillation. For example, if you are given sugar water and you need to separate sugar water as a mixture, how are you going to do it? That is very important for you to understand. And again, if you go back to your study guide, all those explanations and processes have been defined in detail. And for that specific unit, it's also very important that you understand how chemical is used in everyday life, because all the things that we do every day are influenced by the different chemicals and chemical reactions. So it's very important to understand the different chemical properties and how the different chemical substances are used in daily lives. And Unit 2, it's one of the most important units that you also need to understand, because they deal with atoms, elements, molecules, and compounds. And like I have highlighted already before, one of the things that you are expected to know as part of this subject is to understand bonding and how different elements react. And for you to understand the reactions of different elements, you need to understand an atom and the atom structures. And I have given you an example on that slide in terms of the structure of a carbon atom. Very important is for you to understand that every atom have three structures. They have protons, they have neutrons, and they have electrons. So the protons and the neutrons are usually found in the center, and then the electrons are found in the shells of the elements. In addition to that, you also need to be able to differentiate between atoms and isotopes, and also between atoms and ions. And important to know is that ions are only formed when atoms lose or gain electrons. And that's also one thing that we are going to look at shortly, how atoms lose electrons or how they gain electrons depending on where they are situated in a periodic table. On the next slide, if you look at there is a structure of an electron, and I've just used hydrogen and magnesium to demonstrate how the electrons are found in the different shells of the atoms. For example, with hydrogen only have one atom. Sorry, it only have one proton, and because of that, there is only one shell, and that is found in that only existing shell of the hydrogen. But if you look at magnesium, you can see that it have three shells. And the reason why it have three shells is because it have more than enough electrons. And usually the shells are taking up a certain number of electrons. The first shell, which is usually the shell close to the center, can only accommodate two shells. And then the second shell normally is full when it have eight electrons, and then the third and any other shell is usually full when it have eight electrons. So in a nutshell, different atoms usually will gain or lose electrons to be able to obtain full outer shells. And like I said, if the atom only have one shell like hydrogen, it usually only need two shells to be full. But if it's any other, it needs at least to have eight shells to be full. So it will have to either lose or gain electrons to be able to obtain that full shell. And for that to happen, normally, atoms do react with each other. so that they can either give each other electrons or they should gain electrons from each other depending on where they are situated in the periodic table. And when you start looking at Unit 3 of the study guide, it starts talking about the different types of bonding. And like I've already again emphasized earlier, this is one of the critical units for your exam preparation. And you need to understand, first of all, what elements are, and then how they are different from molecules, compounds, and mixtures. And then once you have that understanding, you should be able to differentiate between metals and nonmetals, and how the different metals and nonmetals can be used. And usually, the uses of different metals and nonmetals are determined by their different chemical and physical properties. So it's very important for you to go back to your study guide and be able to differentiate between the physical and the chemical properties of the different metals and nonmetals, and they are well stipulated in your study guide. In addition to that, you need to understand alloys and the use of alloys, as well as be able to understand how ionic bonds and covalent bonds are structured and how they are formed, as well as being able to calculate moles and relative mass of compounds. So in the next few slides, we are going to look at some of the examples of how bonding or how atoms react with each other to be able to obtain full shells in their outer shells. The first example is demonstrating how, for example, sodium and chloride combine or react to form sodium chloride. Now, if you look at your periodic table, the different elements are grouped in the are put in different groups, and usually these groups demonstrate or are there to show how many elements those atoms have in their outer shell. For example, if you look at sodium, sodium is in group one of the periodic table, and what that means is that sodium will have one electron in its outer shell. And then if you look at chlorine, chlorine is found in the group 7 of the periodic table, which means it will have 7 electrons in its outer shell. So now what that means is, going back to what I have said earlier, for sodium to be able to achieve full outer shells, it needs to lose that one electron that it have in its outer shell, whereas chlorine will have to gain that electron to be able to have an outer a full outer shell. Hence, the reaction between sodium and chlorine that results in sodium chloride shows that sodium will lose one electron and chlorine will gain it, so that both have full outer shells. And usually, only when electrons are having full outer shells, they will not be able to react. But for as long as they are having shells or shells in their outer shells which are not full, they will react, because the reason behind their reactions is for them to be able to achieve full outer shells. So having given you an example of ionic bonding, I have also given you an example of covalent bonds. And the difference there really is that when you look at the ionic bonds, atoms simply give up or gain an electron. But in terms of covalent bonds, they do not give up or they do not gain, but they do share electrons, so that they are all having full outer shells. And I have given you two examples there. The first example is demonstrating how hydrogen and chlorine combined to form hydrogen chloride. And then the second example is demonstrating how hydrogen reacts with sulfur to give you hydrogen sulfate. So in the first example, hydrogen is having one electron in its outer shell, but chlorine is having 7. So for these two to be able to achieve full outer shells, they combine so that each one is full, or it's happy and it's unable to react. That's why you can see that hydrogen is reacting with chlorine, and then they get combined, and then hydrogen have its full outer shells, which are now 2 electrons, and then chlorine also gets its 8 electrons in its outer shell, which is then fully achieved. And then when you look at sulfur and hydrogen on the other side, sulfur is having 6 electrons in its outer shell, which means for it to be full, it needs 2 more electrons. So for it to be react with hydrogen, it means it needs to react with 2 hydrogen atoms to be able to achieve its outer shells. That's why you can see that in that case, or in the case of example B, hydrogen is react, or 2 hydrogen atoms are reacting with sulfur atom to be able to achieve their outer shells. So like I said, that is very important for you to be able to understand, because that is one of the critical aspects of your exam paper. And please, if you are not sure, try to get my contact through your coordinator so that I can further explain for you. Because like I said, unfortunately, in the interest of time, I'm unable to give you more examples on how the different elements or atoms are actually reacting with each other to obtain full outer shells. And going forward, another important aspect that you need to know for your exam is to be able to complete equations, either through writing out full word equations or by giving examples of balanced chemical equations. And the next two slides that I'm going to look at there is just to give you again examples as to what word equations are and how balanced equations happens. So if you look at the first example, I have given you an example of when what happens when iron reacts with sulfur. And again, like I said, the reason why iron will react with sulfur is because they all need to achieve outer shells that are full so that they are no longer able to react. And in this case, when you are asked to write a word equation, basically you just give words of what happens when iron reacts with sulfur. So iron reacts with sulfur and they give you iron sulfate. And the two demonstrates or shows that two iron atoms will react with sulfur so that they all achieve their full outer shells. The second example there that you are given is on what happens when magnesium reacts with oxygen. And again, magnesium is found in group 2 and oxygen is found in group 6. So what that means is that for magnesium to obtain its full outer shell, it needs to lose the two cells that it have in its outer shell. Whereas in order for oxygen to obtain its full outer shells, it need to gain or to receive those two electrons from magnesium. So magnesium will give up its two outer electrons, whereas oxygen will receive the two electrons. And once that happens, magnesium oxide is the product. So that is what happens, or that is what's expected of you if you are asked to write a word equation. You simply just write out the words of what happens when the two elements react. But in other instances, you will be asked to be able to give balanced chemical equations. And that is very, very, very important for you guys to be able to do. And again, I emphasize that please, if you are not sure, find my contact through your coordinator and send me an email and then I'll be able to assist you. And the reason why I'm emphasizing that particularly on this is because I know that students usually are very much challenged in terms of balanced chemical equations. And it's not an easy task, but it's very, very important for you to be able to do, hence my emphasis. So I have given you two examples of chemical equations just to demonstrate again how different atoms or elements react with each other to be able to further achieve full outer shells. So in the first example, I have demonstrated how ammonia is formed. And ammonia is a compound that is formed when nitrogen reacts with hydrogen. So for nitrogen and hydrogen to react to form ammonia, there need to be two nitrogen atoms that will combine with three hydrogen molecules to be able to form ammonia. And again, for you to be able to do this, you need to go back and do what I have done earlier. Try to unpack the nitrogen atoms as well as the hydrogen atoms to see what they have in their outer shells and why they need to be combining in those quantities to be able to form ammonia. And very important for you guys to understand is that for you to be able to do balanced equations, you need to know that the number of electrons before the equation or before the arrow must be equivalent or equal to the number of electrons after the arrow. So the reactants must be in the same as the product. And that is how you actually tell that you are having a balanced equation. So if you are having two nitrogen before the arrow, then there should also be two after the arrow. If there is only one, then it must be one. Otherwise, if you have two nitrogen before the arrow and then you have two nitrogen as a product, then it means somewhere, somehow your equation is not balanced. And when I talk about product, I think you know that usually whatever is before the arrow is what is called reactants, and then what you find after the arrow is the product. So in that very same example that I have given you, when nitrogen reacts with hydrogen to give you ammonia, ammonia becomes the product, and nitrogen and hydrogen are the reactants. And then again, the other example that I have given you in terms of balanced chemical equations or to understand how chemicals are being balanced is the example between magnesium and oxygen. So usually magnesium bends in oxygen. And when the two reacts, magnesium oxide is produced. Like, and I have already given you that example earlier to say that for magnesium to react with oxygen, it means magnesium need to give up its two electrons and oxygen need to receive those two electrons. So that's a very simple and straightforward example. And again, like I said, now you can see in your product that magnesium is two after the arrow, just like it is before in the reactants. And then oxygen is also two after the equation or after the arrow or in the product, just like it is in the reactant. So it's very important to always count what is before the arrow and what is after. And only if they are the same or if they are equal, then it means your chemical equation is balanced. Otherwise, you need to rework. And like I said, sometimes the best way to do that is to go back and write out the full structures of the different atoms that are reacting to be able to tell who is going to gain and who is going to lose and how the two can then combine to both achieve their full outer shells. And then the other thing that is very important, if you look at unit 5 of your study guide, it looks at production of energy, energetic and speed of reactions. So I have given you examples of some of the chemical reactions that happens. Now when chemical reactions happen, usually they can happen at different speeds or at different rates. And the way that will happen will be determined on certain factors. And those factors are usually either the concentration, and usually the concentration is the concentration of the reactants, whether it's highly concentrated or less concentrated. And it will also be determined by the temperature. If the temperatures, for example, are too low, then the reaction will also be too low. But if the temperature is optimal, which means it's at its best, then the reaction will be also at its best. And then often there also need to be a catalyst, which is like an extra product that will trigger or that will speed up the reaction of a chemical reaction. And then the other thing is about the surface area, that if you're having a large surface area, then it means the chemical reaction is going to be faster. And it's very important again to go back to your study guide and see how, or to actually understand with examples, how the different factors that I have just named can actually influence the chemical reaction. And like I said, usually it will influence it by either reducing it or by increasing it. So you need to know, when does it get speeded up and when does it get slowed down, and what can you do to be able to speed up a chemical reaction. And then the three concepts that you also need to understand, or four concepts that you also need to understand, it's oxidation, reduction, and then oxidation agents and reduction as agents, as well as redox reactions. And I have defined them for you, but again, if you go back to your study guide, all those explanations, definitions with examples are there. So to differentiate between exothermic and endothermic reactions is simply that exothermic reactions are the ones that gives out energy. And then in some cases, chemical reactions takes in energy. So in some cases, they release energy. And where they release energy, they are called exothermic. But in some cases, they take in energy to be able to take place. So whenever they take in energy, they are called endothermic. And I've given you examples of what happens, for example, when methane bends in oxygen, that what is produced there is carbon dioxide, water, and heat energy. So that is why methane bending in oxygen is an example of exothermic, because they produce heat energy or they give off heat energy. But in terms of nitrogen and oxygen, when the two combine, they give off nitrogen oxide. But for them to be able to combine, they need energy. And that is why that is an example of an endothermic process. And then the other two concepts that I've said you need to know is oxidation and reduction. Again, those are two opposite reactions. That with oxidation, that is usually the process that happens when, for example, hydrogen and magnesium combine with oxygen. But in other reactions, the process of oxygen is removed. So in one case, it gets combined, but in one case, it gets removed. So whenever it gets removed, that example is called reduction. But reduction and oxidation processes, they always happen together. Because in one case, one is added, but in the other case, it gets removed. So these are like reversible reactions. hence they are called redox reactions. And I have given you an example of a redox reaction between magnesium and oxygen. And again, I have already used that example before, but I'm just trying to use it over and over so that you can actually understand the different concepts. So in this case, when you look at a redox reaction and then magnesium combined with oxygen, magnesium become oxidized because it's the one that is losing its electrons in its outer shells. But oxygen becomes reduced because it's the one that is gaining the two electrons that magnesium is losing. So that's why I say these two always happen together, because as much as one is losing, the other one is gaining. So they don't happen separately, they happen together. And then unit 6 is looking at acids, bases and salts, and that is very straightforward. Go back to your study guide, understand the differences between these three concepts, and also be able to understand how the reactions of acids with carbonates, with litmus paper and with universal indicator happens. And you also need to understand how protons transfer acids as well as bases in solutions. And then be able to differentiate between strong and weak acids, of course, with examples, and also how the different salts are being separated and how they are prepared and how they can be purified. But I'm not going to get into details of that unit 6 because, like I said, it's very straightforward. All you need to do is to go back and read and differentiate between those different types of concepts. And unit 7, very essential, it's about the periodic table. I have already alluded to some of these things, but again, you need to know that for the sake of the exam, you are usually provided with a copy of a periodic table. But very important, you need to be able to understand how to work with the periodic table. So what that means is that you must know, for example, how elements are classified in the periodic table, how the different groups are numbered and why they are numbered the way they are numbered. And then you must be able to use it to describe the properties of different groups, especially group 1 and group 2, and be able to predict the properties of elements in a group given some data, as well as being able to describe the group properties of group 7. And very, very important is to be able to understand and explain why the elements that are found in group 8, which is also called noble gases, do not react. And to give you that answer now, it simply means because all the elements that are in group 8, they are having full outer shells, they do not react. Because I already told you earlier that the reason why the elements react, it's because they are trying to achieve full outer shells. But those elements that are in group 8, they are already full, so there is no need for them to react. Because there's no need for them to lose or gain. They're already full, so they are stable. So they don't need to react to achieve any of those full outer shells. And then unit 8 looks at properties, extraction, and uses of metals. So very, very important, like I have already again highlighted earlier, it's for you to be able to understand the physical properties of metals and nonmetals, and that should be able to guide you in explaining why different metals and nonmetals are used in different things, because it's their properties that determine how and where they are used. And very important is also to understand how the different metals react with water, how they react with hydrochloric acid, and how they also react with other metals. If you go back to your unit 8 in your study guide, I have given you plenty of examples as to how that happens. And again, if you are not sure, do not hesitate to email me. And understand the concept of metal ores and how the different metals are being extracted using, for example, the process of electrolysis. And you need to go back again to understand how that process happens to be able to extract metals from their ores. Differentiating between alloys and use of alloys. And very important is to understand the concept of rust. We all know that metals do rust. Of course, you need to know when that happens and what causes it to happen and how rusting can be prevented. And I have mentioned the four processes of concepts that are there to prevent rusting, one of them being coating, painting, greasing, and also plating. And then be able to justify why it is very important to prevent metals from rusting. And also to understand why some elements such as aluminium are not reactive. And I think I've already given you an answer before, that elements that are in their noble gases or that are found in the last group of the periodic table are non-reactive because they are having full outer shells. So that includes aluminium. Unit 9, very straightforward, looking at industrial uses and application of chemistry. It's about reading and going back. But again, very important for that unit, it's to be able to understand how calcium reacts with calcium carbonate. And it's also very important for you to understand how lime is being used, as well as calcium hydroxide and calcium carbonates. Be able to understand acidity of the soil and how that can influence crops, for example, in farming, as well as liming. And also be able to demonstrate how one can test for water, especially the chemical test for water. It's well explained in your study guide. I have already spoken about the importance of understanding extraction of salts, as well as the process of hydration and how water is purified, as well as the use of water in industry. I think that you can be able to relate at least, as well as the use of oxygen and how carbon dioxide is produced. Like I said, this is a very straightforward unit, but it doesn't mean it's less important. I'm just not going to spend a lot of time on it because of time issues. But please do go back and read. And then the second last unit in your study guide is on organic chemistry and structures of compounds, alkenes, alcohol and esters. These are very, very important concepts. You need to know the difference between alkenes and alkanes. You need to know what esters are. You need to know how esters are being used. You need to understand their basic chemistry. And you also need to understand how ethanol is being used and what it is, as well as its different properties. So again, if you go back to Unit 10, I have given you all the clear examples of what is an alkyne, what are the properties of alkanes, how are the alkanes named, and what are the most important things to remember about alkanes. Similarly, if you think about alkenes, it does again stipulate in your study guide what alkenes are, what their properties are, how they are being named, and what the key things are that you need to remember about them. And the same applies to esters. So again, please do go back, familiarize yourself with those concepts, be able to give the differences, be able to see how the three are named and why they are named the way they are named. And also very important is for you to know the structures of the different concepts. Know what alkanes are, how they are structured. Know what esters are and what their basic chemistry structures are like. And then of course, you should be able to explain what alcohol is and what is being used for, that is ethanol. And that again is clearly stipulated in your study guide. And then the last unit, which is very straightforward, it's the impact of chemistry on the environment. First, under that unit, to know, like I've already said, because it's also given in the previous unit, is to understand how you test for the presence of water. So how do you do it, especially the chemical test for water? And then you need to understand atmospheric pollution as well as the sources of air pollutants. And we all know that, for example, things like gas exhaust, things like industries, they all produce reactions or pollutants. But these pollutants do have effects to the air, to the animals, to the plants, and everything else. So with that specific unit, it's very important to understand the dangers and the effects of these different pollutants in the air. And those pollutants can be carbon monoxide, they can be sulfur dioxide, they can be carbon dioxide, and all those different pollutants. So you must be able to give examples as to how, for example, they can be of effect to acid rains, or how they can cause death to some species, or for example, cause diseases in some cases, because we do inhale some of those pollutants. And of course, that's not good for our health. And then lastly, you need to understand how dangerous chemicals affect the environment. So I'm not sure whether I have assisted you to the extent that you were hoping for, but like I said, please, if you are not sure about any of those things that I've spoken about, send me an email, and then with enough time, I will be able to unpack and give you more details and explanations. But at least I hope what I have said have given you some ideas as to what is expected of you to be able to write or pass your April exam for Natural Science and Health 6. So good luck for your exams.